The following program is brought to you in living color on NBC. Plymouth, a product of Chrysler Corporation, and your neighborhood Plymouth dealer invite you to see and drive the 1960 Plymouth, built a new solid way to give you solid satisfaction and to enjoy the Steve Allen Plymouth Show, presenting William Bendix, Beat Generation novelist Jack Kerouac, singing star Pam Garner, extra added attraction Frankie Lane, Louis Nye, Don Knotts, Pat Harrington Jr., Dayton Allen, Gabe Dell, Les Brown, and his band of renown. And here he is, Steve Allen!
Shots back again for those of you who asked to see them. And now, rolling right downhill, let's listen to an exciting new arrangement of Lover Come Back to Me. And here to sing it, coming in hot from the Dunes Hotel in Las Vegas, is the fabulous Frankie Lane. Right.
You went away, I let you. We broke the ties that bind. I wanted to forget you and leave the past behind. Still, the magic of the night I met you seems to be forever in my mind. Sky is blue, high above, moon is new, so is love. This eager heart of mine is singing, a lover, where can you be? We came at last, love had its day, that day is past, you've gone away. This aching heart of mine is singing, lover, come back to me. When I remember every little thing you used to do, I'm so lonely. Every road I walk along with you. No wonder I am lonely. Sky is blue, night is cold, moon is new, love is old. And while I'm waiting here, this heart of mine is singing, lover, come back, lover, come back, lover, come back to me. Is blue, high above, the moon is new, so is love. This eager heart of mine is singing, lover, where can you be? You came at last, love had its day, that day is past, you've gone away. This aching heart of mine is singing, lover, come back to me. When I remember every little thing you used to do, I'm so lonely. Every road I walk along with you. No wonder I am lonely. The sky is blue, night is cold, the moon is new, but love is old. And while I'm waiting here, this heart of mine is singing, lover, come back, lover, come back, lover, come back, lover, come back.
It's a doggone shame about some of these cars today. They get a few years old and they gotta be sold away. They just shake, rattle and roll. 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 But the situation is finally in control. With the Plymouth 60, there's a new day dawning for you. With the Plymouth 60, there's a new day dawning for you. With the smoothest riding car you ever knew.
No more shake, rattle and roll.
No.
No more shake, rattle and roll.
No.
No more shake, rattle and roll.
No.
No more shake, rattle and roll.
Oh.
No more shake,
rattle and roll. Go!
Drive a Plymouth 60, the answer to all your dreams.
All your dreams. Drive a Plymouth 60, the answer to all your dreams.
All your dreams.
When you ride inside, you glide on sweet moonbeams.
Sweet moonbeams. No more shake, rattle and roll. No more shake, rattle and roll. No more shake, rattle and roll. No more shake, rattle and roll.
That's the sweetest story that anyone ever told.
No more shake, no more rattle, no more roll.
Solid 460. Plymouth.
built a new solid way to give you solid satisfaction.
This is the time of year when millions of people come down with an ailment known as the common cold. Now, since so many people are affected, we have deemed it worthy of coverage by the Allen Report to the Nation. Tonight, reporting on the common cold.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and common cold lovers. The common cold has plagued mankind since the beginning of time. This fact has become known through a recent discovery by a group of archaeologists. While working in a cave in the province of Kashmir, Tibet, they uncovered this small rock tablet with some meaningless inscriptions on it. Only recently have they been able to decipher this inscription, which established the fact that man had colds as early as 2 million years ago, and chalk was just a new invention, however. And this is how it worked out. My friends, listen to it fizz. You can see that after 2 million years, there is still no known cure for the common cold. However, man is still trying. Millions of dollars a year are being spent on medicines and drugs for the relief of colds. To find out more about this, we're going to visit the factory of the biggest manufacturer of patent medicines for the common cold. We take you now to Radcliffe, Texas. It's a rocky flight, where we will meet Norman P. Radcliffe of the Radcliffe Laboratories. There he is. Hello, Mr. Radcliffe.
Chavez Ravine!
Chavez Ravine? Oh, well, never mind that. How are you? Mr. Radcliffe, I understand you are the world's leading manufacturer of patent medicines for colds.
That's correct.
And how long have you been in business, sir?
47 years.
Mm-hmm.
47 years. You see that? That's my huge factory. When I first came out here in 1894, there was nothing out here but coyotes, lizards, prairie dogs, and buffalo grass.
I see. Now tell me, sir, what did you use in making your medicine?
Coyotes, lizards, prairie dogs, and buffalo grass. I ground them all up together and made my first batch in a bathtub.
In a bathtub? My goodness. Was it successful?
Yes, but it left a ring around your stomach.
Oh, come on. I wonder if we could see your line of cold remedies.
Yes, I could. First, I would like to tell you about Does It.
Uh-huh.
For relief of cold miseries and sinus congestion.
Yes.
I'd like to demonstrate it for you, and I'll call in one of our more severe cases.
All right.
Here he is.
I've seen him, yes.
These are the 8 sinus cavities.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Bradley, if you'll please take one of these Does It pills. Here we are.
I see. Now tell me, what does that pill do?
Yes, you are. It makes the head numb so it doesn't hurt when I pull off the tape. Hit up. Up. Take a breath. Right, good boy.
Immediate right. Relief.
Very
yes.
Good.
What else?
There's a remedy I'm still working on. We call it Project 79.
My goodness. What the heck is that?
I don't know, but it's twice as fast as buffering.
Thank you, Mr. Radcliffe. Well, I guess that about covers everything, huh?
No, I have one more thing. Come over here to show you. It's not out yet on the market, this pill, but this is my latest pill.
It's so big. My goodness, you take that?
No, it takes you.
Help him. Year after year, millions of working hours are lost due to the common cold, and millions of dollars are being spent to find a cure. All over the country, scientists and bacteriologists are working day and night to find this cure. Let's visit one of these tireless bacteriologists. who has dedicated his life to trying to isolate the common cold germ. His name is Professor Dorton, and we see him now hard at work in his laboratory. Hello, Professor Dorton.
Oh, good evening, Mr. Murrow. I'd like to welcome you to my laboratory.
Fine. How long have you been working in this laboratory, Professor?
47 years. And
I see. Watch it there. Why are you so interested in bacteria, germs, and viruses?
Because they bug me.
I noticed that you have some medals on your filthy smock there. What are those for?
Well, I'm glad you asked me, Mr. Allen. This is for the Peabody Award, and this is for the Pulitzer Prize, and this is for bowling.
Careful there. Tell me, Doctor, have you come anywhere near to isolating the cold virus?
The what?
The common cold germ, or whatever.
Oh, yes. Yes, well, I was just looking at some cold germs over here. Now, if you'll just move your camera in close, I'll show you first what a healthy cold germ looks like.
All right, let's see if we can get a shot with our...
There, now, you just saw a healthy cold germ.
He looks great.
Now, the healthy cold germs do not cause any trouble until they become sick.
Oh.
Now, let's take a look. Here's a sick cold germ.
Ah, yeah. Poor little thing. Well, that's very interesting.
Yes, well, here's something very interesting.
Be careful, man.
Here's something very interesting.
Yes, what is in that tube?
Millions of sick cold germs of the type you just saw under the microscope. Listen.
Listen, I can't help noticing that you keep breaking things. Why do you do that?
I hope to discover something by accident.
By accident?
Oh, always happens that way in the movies.
I see. Well, good luck. Professor, by the way, a moment ago I noticed some things on your other table here. What are those little things? Yes, those. What are they?
Oh, these. Well, this is a simple molecular structure showing the single cell of a cold germ.
Oh.
Now, this is what happens to the molecular structure of the cold germ when a person sneezes. It increases into millions of cells, infecting the entire area.
Remarkable. What are the others?
Well, this is a horsey, and this is a...
Thank you very much, Professor. Good night. Thanks. Well, sir, now that we've heard from a drug manufacturer and a bacteriologist, let's hear what the all-important family doctor has to say. We take you now to Yonkers, New York, where we will visit the man who was just voted the family doctor of the year. Wonderful Dr. Whitney Ellsworth. There he is. Caught him shaving. Dr. Ellsworth? Dr. Ellsworth?
Yes, excuse me. I was merely doing something.
Certainly. It's really a pleasure, sir, to meet a man who was voted the family doctor of the year, Dr. Ellsworth.
Yes, well, forget that Dr. Ellsworth stuff. You can call me what all my patients call me.
And what is that?
Quack.
I can see that. Tell me, sir, how long have you been practicing?
47 years.
And when did you first become interested in medicine?
This morning.
Do you know anything about viruses?
Are you kidding? Simply ask me a question.
All right. All right. Do you know anything about viruses?
No.
Fair enough. And what do you give your patients?
30 days. Sometimes less, depending on how sick they are. Or maybe the name of a good doctor.
I see.
I do that sometimes. Yes, sometimes. I do both of those. Now, oh, my goodness.
What are you... I don't understand, sir. What are you listening to there?
And there goes Jack Howard fading back for a long pass, and he took it on the 10-yard line. He's up to...
Wait a minute. How can you get a football game on a stethoscope?
Because the baseball season is over.
I see. That's logical enough. Well, I see you have all the very latest medical equipment, Doctor.
You know it, Sal. Now, some of it is really brand new, and others I have never even had in here before.
I have a $65,000 x-ray machine, a $75,000 fluoroscope, and a $100,000 diathermy thing.
My goodness, that's quite an investment for a family doctor. How do you manage that?
I save Rolly coupon. And this isn't all. Do you know what I'm going to get tomorrow for 3,400 Rolly coupon?
No, no, what?
3 cartons of Chesterfield.
Before we go, doctor, do you have any advice for the millions of young doctors of tomorrow?
Yes, I do.
What is it?
Don't double park.
Thank you and good night, Dr. Furman. And a good night to all of you wherever you are. Just a couple of seconds now while we're getting ready for some more laughs to talk about books. I have 2 of them to recommend to you this evening. The first is this, Exodus by Leon Uris. It may seem peculiar that I'm recommending a book which is already on the bestseller list, but it's my point to point out that the book is now available in a paperback cover. The book is widely popular because it's exciting fiction, but I bring it to your attention now because I think you'll also find it educational. The next book is Gentlemen, Scholars, and Scoundrels, a treasury of the best of Harper's Magazine from 1850 to the present. This is a book that'll bring reading pleasure, obviously, not just for 2 or 3 evenings, but down through the years. I think it would make an excellent Christmas gift. Gentlemen, Scholars, and Scoundrels. Nope. Guess again. It's not Richard Diamond coming up now, as some of you might think. It's Pete Rugolo's theme for the show, all right, but it's now known as The Girl with the Long Black Hair. And here's a girl with short red hair, lovely Pam Garner, to sing it for you.
Was in Berkeley Square that he met the girl with the long black hair. He was lonely that night when she suddenly came inside. She smiled. It was strange.
Hi there. Let's talk about fins for a moment. You know, besides being very good looking, they perform an important function. I'd like to show you just why the Plymouth car has fins. Incidentally, we call them stabilizers. And we're going to use a tank of water and this little toy boat
to illustrate the stabilizing effect of fins. Well, let's take the little boat and remove the rudder. So, now watch what happens. There, you notice without the rudder, the little boat has no direction. Well, now we'll put the rudder back in position. Start the motor, and look. Away she goes, straight and true. Well, the rudder of a boat is much the same as Plymouth stabilizer fins. It stabilizes. It helps bring the center of pressure back toward the rear, where engineers will tell you it belongs for better handling. So there you have it. Why Plymouth has fins. Better handling. Wind tunnel tests show that Plymouth's real stabilizers make it 20% easier to steer in a crosswind. Now, there's only one way you can really appreciate Plymouth. Drive it. Experience the remarkable stability, the unusual ease of handling made possible by Plymouth's new stabilizer design. See your dealer soon and try the new solid Plymouth. We think it's the best built, best performing car in the low price field. Plymouth, solid 460, is a Chrysler engineered product.
Very good advice indeed. Well, sir, you might recall reading recently. You might. I'm sure you will. There are some television programs, usually those filmed without a studio audience, that have to resort to the use of pre-recorded or canned laughter. I believe it was Dr. Frank Stanton of CBS who did most to bring this to the attention of American audiences. And there are those, of course, who argue that because there is no studio audience present, in other words, no one to laugh at the jokes on some of these film shows, that the use of canned laughter is therefore justified because it helps to stimulate laughter in you people at home. Be that as it may, the problem is not so much the use of the device as it is the abuse of it. Some individual producers might become so worried about the fate of their shows that they would use canned laughter indiscriminately. And right now, with the help of William Bendix, we'll show you what we mean. First, we're going to take a look at an ordinary, just plain folks at home type program, very dull little scene. Show is not as popular as the producer would like it to be. Here it is.
Good morning, darling.
Good morning, dear.
Aren't the children up yet?
Oh, they'll be down soon.
Where's my blue tie?
In the hall closet.
I'll have to do something about this door.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad.
Morning, Mom.
Hi, dear.
Dad?
Good morning, son.
Say, Dad, can I use the car tonight?
I'm sorry, son, but I have to use the car tonight.
Oh, but, Dad, I got a heavy date.
But you had the car last night and the night before.
But, Dad, this is important. I'll tell you what, if you loan me the car tonight, I'll wash it and I'll polish it Saturday.
No, son.
I'm tired of you two bickering about the car. Now stop it. This is no way to start the day off. Let's all sit down and eat.
Oh, I don't feel like having any breakfast this morning. Besides, I'll be late for school. Oh, by the way, Mom, I won't be home for dinner.
Be careful when you cross the street, son.
Okay, Pop.
Oh, I know. I think I can go. I sure hope so, but I haven't asked.
Doesn't that girl ever get off the phone?
You know how teenagers are, dear.
I can't afford all these telephone bills. I've got to put a stop to this.
Oh, so long, Robin. I've got to hang up. I think Dad's angry. I missed my bus.
Well, I'm off to the old grind. Goodbye, dear.
Goodbye, sweetheart.
Well, that's it. Pretty dull, see? Now, in order to create excitement where it does not actually exist, the same program might resort to the use of canned laughter, and if it happened, the results could be something as follows.
Good morning, darling.
morning, dear.
Aren't the children up yet?
Oh, they'll be down soon.
Where's my blue tie?
In the hall closet.
I'll have to do something about this door.
Good morning, Mom.
Hi, sweet.
Dad?
Good morning, son.
Say, Dad, can I use the car tonight?
I'm sorry, son. I have to use the car tonight.
But, Dad, I've got a heavy day.
But you had the car last night and the night before.
but, Dad, this is important. If you loan me the car tonight, I'll tell you, I'll wash it and I'll polish it this Saturday.
No, son.
I'm tired of you two bickering about the car. Now stop it. This is no way to start the day off. Let's all sit down and eat.
No, I don't feel like having any breakfast, Mom. Besides, I'll be late for school. Oh, by the way, Mom, I won't be home for dinner tonight.
Be careful when you cross the street, son. Doesn't that girl ever get off the phone?
Dear, you know how teenagers are.
But I can't afford these telephone bills. I've got to put a stop to this.
So long, Robin. I've got to hang up. I think Dad's angry. I'll miss my bus.
Well, I'm off to the old grind. Bye, dear.
Goodbye. Well, that's one way of making your show seem better than it actually is, but obviously it's not a really wise solution. Down through the long history of the drama, and as thousands of successful motion pictures will attest, it has been established that violence pays off at the box office. Even our newspapers, for example, will put a sensational murder story on page one sooner than they might sometimes for a story of, say, social or political significance. So against this background, our imaginary TV producer of the same situation comedy might resort to the addition of violence to stir up audience interest. Let's see how this might work out.
Good morning, darling.
Good morning, dear.
Aren't the children up yet?
Oh, they'll be down soon.
Where's my blue tie?
In the hall closet.
I'll have to do something about this door.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad.
Morning, Momsville. Daddy-o.
Morning, son.
Hey, Dad, can I use the car tonight?
Sorry, son, I have to use the car tonight.
But I got a heavy day.
You had the car last night.
Oh!
And the night before!
But, Dad, now listen to me. This is important. Now, if you loan me the car tonight, I'll wow! And I'll pounce!
No, son.
I'm tired of you two bickering about the car. Now stop it. The day off. Let's all sit down and eat.
Sorry, Mom. I don't feel like eating any breakfast. Besides, I'll be late for school. Mom, by the way, I won't be home for dinner tonight.
careful when you cross the street, son. Doesn't that girl ever get off the phone?
You know how teenagers are, dear.
I can't afford all these phone bills. I've got to put a stop to this.
I think Dad's angry. I'll miss my bus.
Well, I'm off to the old grind. Bye, dear.
Bye, darling.
Thank you very much, Bill Bendix. I love that they listen to everybody, but I'm not sure exactly who. Now, while we're getting ready for some more laughs, it's time, as the music indicates, to spend just a few seconds with our Billboard girl. Tonight, it's a beautiful young actress named Vicki Dugan. Here she is. Are the writing machine here? It's our custom, Vicki, to ask the folks who do this particular show in their hometown. Where are you from?
Well, I'm from New York, Stephen, although I was brought up upstate New York.
Well, as I always say, I'm sure you have a great many of your good friends watching tonight, and you've probably made a great many more now by just being here. Now, if you're around next week, Vicki, you'll be able to see on our program the wonderful Mickey Rooney. And we're also going to swing with your good friend and mine, Mel Torme. And a very fine singer indeed, the one and only June Christie. Now, wait a minute. Don't applaud for this next name, Belle Montrose, because not too many of you are hip to the scene. This is my mother, actually. And, don't applaud for me. I had nothing to do with it, you know. But anyway, that's the scene. This picture was taken about 4,000 years ago, but it was it was the only one I had of mother. She, as some of you may know, was a vaudeville actress and a very prominent and popular one for many years. And next week, an answer to requests we've been getting for about 10 years, Mother and I are going to do her old act. I'm going to play straight as my father used to. If you want to see how it was in those days, tune in next week. And remember, last week I said that next week the Nutty Squirrels were going to be with us. Well, I goofed. It is next week. It's not tonight. They ran out of nuts or something on the way out here, and we'll have them with us next week. We'll be doing the Nutty Squirrels record. And, of course, our own wonderful gang of guys every week. And thank you very much, Vicki Dugan. We'll see you soon. Thank you. And now, Pat Harrington, would you take over for just a moment? Because there's a friend of mine I've got to talk
sir.
About.
Yes, there. I will. As a public service over the years, the Steve Allen Show has presented the Question Man, a gentleman who has devoted his life to providing questions for the answers you people send in. He can find the question for any answer by simply flipping through his files. And here is that simple flip now, the Question Man. I think we're ready. All right, sit down.
Good evening. May I have the first answer, please?
Yes, the first answer is from Lloyd David in Reno, Nevada. His answer is 5'2", eyes of blue. The question, please.
Question is, what does it say on Mickey Rooner's driver? Mickey Rooney's driver's license? I'm sorry. Mickey Rooner's
well, see
driving
if you're
license.
I'm answer this one.
I couldn't answer that one, so I don't know. Go ahead, give me another.
This one is from Charles Pond in Dallas, Texas. It is horsewhipped. The question, please.
Question is, what's a good description of any TV show that's opposite a Western?
Well, at least you answered that. Here's one from Jules Lander in Royal Oaks, California. It reads, UCLA. The question, please.
Question is, what do you see when the smog lifts?
Oh. Glad to see the hand is better. Will you please pay attention?
Yes.
Here's a short answer from a gentleman in Texas. Millionaire. The question, please.
The question is, what do you call a billionaire after taxes?
Here is an interesting answer from a gentleman in Cincinnati. It's a long way to Tipperary. The question, please.
The question is, why do you get tired if you walk to Tipperary?
Oh, I see, because it's a long way to Tipperary, yes.
Yes, I'll die by myself if you don't mind.
A young lady from Galesburg, Illinois, sends in the next answer.
Send her in.
It is RSVP. The question, please.
The question is, how do you spell Roosevelt?
And Mr. Ronald Reese from Billings, Montana, sends in the next answer.
And none too soon, either.
It's a guess. It's a guess. The question, please.
The question is, like, man, how do you describe carbon monoxide? Follow the bouncing ball.
Oh, I see there, yes. Well, we have time for one more. Mr. Jerome Escrow of Great Neck, Long Island, gives us this answer. United Artists. The question, please.
Question is, what do you call Siamese twins that go into show business?
I'm sorry we had time for one more. Thank you and good night.
'50s, the nation recognized in its midst a social movement called Beat Generation. A novel titled On the Road became a bestseller, and its author, Jack Kerouac, became a celebrity, partly because he'd written a powerful and successful book, and partly because he seemed to be the embodiment of this new generation. Jack and I made an album together a few months back in which I played background piano for his poetry reading. And at that time, I made a note to book him on the show because I thought you would enjoy meeting him. So here he is, Jack Kerouac. told me a little earlier was nervous. Are you nervous now? No? Good. Jack, got a couple of square questions, but I think the answers will be interesting. How long did it take you to write On the Road?
3 weeks.
How many?
3 weeks.
3 weeks? Geez, that's amazing. How long were you on the road itself?
7 years.
7 years. Yeah, I was on the road once for 3 weeks, and it took me 7 years to write about it. Well, the other way around. I've heard that you write so fast that you don't like to use regular typing paper, but instead you prefer to use one big, long roll of paper. Is that true?
Yeah. When I write narrative novels, and I want to change my narrative thought, I keep going.
You don't want to change the pages at the end, you mean?
100-foot-long teletype paper.
Oh, teletype rolls. Where do you get them?
Huh?
Where do you get the paper?
Yeah, teletype paper.
I mean, where do you get it?
In a very good stationery store.
I see.
When I write my symbolistic, serious, impressionistic novels, I write them in pencil.
Oh, yeah? I've seen a lot of your poetry written in pencil, but I didn't realize that's how you worked on the prose stuff.
For narrative, it's good.
Yeah, I got the most hard question of all, but everybody always puts it to you, I'm sure. I mean, because everybody always puts it to you. How would you define the word beat? I don't mean why not time. I mean, really,
sympathetic.
Sympathetic? All right, I ask. Well, about this point, naturally, we plan to have Jack read some poetry. And while looking again through his book the other day, it struck me, it occurred to me all over again, that his prose is extremely poetic. I think it's probably more poetic than that. Who else writes poetic type prose? Thomas Wolfe, I guess.
Walt Whitman.
Uh-huh.
In Specimen Days. Walt Whitman in Specimen Days.
I see. I thought you were putting me on there for a
minute.
All right, we'll look into that. And right now, we'll look into Jack Kerouac's On the Road, and he'll lay a little on you. You know, you don't even have to buy these pages. I'll try. I'll play the blues as we did in the thing, and we'll see how it works out.
Well, a lot of people have asked me, why did I write that book or any book? All the stories I wrote were true, because I believed in what I saw. I was traveling west one time at the junction of the state line of Colorado, its arid western one, and the state line of poor Utah. I saw in the clouds, huge and massed above the fiery golden desert of Evenfall, the great image of God with forefinger pointed straight at me through halos and rolls and gold folds that were like the existence of a gleaming spear in his right hand, which saith, come on, boy, go thou across the ground. Go moan for man. Go moan. Go groan. Go groan alone. Go roll your bones alone. Go thou and be little beneath my sight. Go thou and be minute as seed in the pod. Go thou, die hence. And of this world, report you well and truly. Anyway, I wrote the book because we're all gonna die. In the loneliness of my life, my father dead, my brother dead, my mother far away, my sister and my wife far away. Nothing here but my own tragic hands that once were guarded by a world of sweet attention, that now are left to guide and disappear their own way into the common dark of all our death. Sleeping in me raw bed alone and stupid, with just this one pride and consolation. My heart broke in the general despair and opened up inwards to the Lord. I made a supplication in this dream. So in the last page of On the Road, I describe how the hero, Dean Moriarty's come to see me all the way from the West Coast just for a day or two. We've just been back and forth across the country several times in cars, and now our adventures are over. We're still great friends, but we have to go into later phases of our lives. So there he goes, Dean Moriarty, ragged in the moth-eaten overcoat he brought specially for the freezing temperatures of the East, walking off alone, and last I saw him, he rounded the corner of 7th Avenue, eyes on the street ahead, and bent to it again. Gone. So, in America, when the sun goes down, and I sit on the old broken down river pier watching the long, long skies over New Jersey and sense all that raw land that rolls in one unbelievable huge bulge over to the West Coast and all that road going and all the people dreaming in the immensity of it. And in Iowa, I know by now that children must be crying in the land where they let the children cry. And tonight the stars will be out. And don't you know that God is Pooh Bear? The evening star must be drooping and shedding her sparkler dims on the prairie, which is just before the coming of complete night that blesses the earth, darkens all the rivers, cups the peaks, and folds the final shore in. Nobody, nobody knows what's going to happen to anybody besides the forlorn rags of growing old. Think of Dean Moriarty, or even think of old Dean Moriarty, the father we never found. Think of Dean Moriarty, I think of Dean Moriarty.
Yeah, wow, Jack, thank you very much. Jack Kerouac, it's a kick. Right now, I'd like to have a word with the fella I saw out in the street a while ago here. Let's see. Ah, yes, there you are. Just arrived in town, I see, sir.
Huh? Oh, no. Oh, my, no.
Oh? Well, you're just leaving, then?
Oh, no, no. I'm just going to put these bags in my car.
Oh, you're taking a little motor trip.
Well, I planned a motor trip, but I'm not actually going. You see, I get a big kick out of planning motor trips, but I can't stand being away from home.
Oh.
So I just map out a long trip, put my empty bags in the car, and then, well, I just drive around the block.
It's been nice talking to you. I'll see you later.
Well, this year I'm planning not to drive to Salt Lake City, Bar Harbor, Maine, and Medicine Hat, Wisconsin. Why, Mr. Allen, in the next 3 years, I figure I won't drive a total of 165,000 miles.
Well, that's lucky for your car.
Oh, gracious, my car could take it all right. It's a solid 60 Plymouth.
Yeah?
It's got a life expectancy of 200,000 miles. Now, the average driver like me drives around town, oh, about 35,000 miles in 3 years. Mm-hmm. And that gives me 165,000 for trips I won't take.
Yeah, well, I know now that Plymouth is solid, but 200,000 miles?
Oh, yes. You see, as Pete Hansen told me...
Now, here's the reason why Plymouth has a life expectancy of 200,000 miles. Dura Quiet Unibody Construction. You see, Plymouth's body and undersills are welded together into one solid unit of tremendous strength. Now, compare that with this other method of construction. That is, a separate body and frame fastened together with bolts like this to work loose and rattle and cause trouble. Welded unibody construction gives you just one tight, sturdy steel structure to help keep Plymouth solid for a long, long time. Also, there are many other quality features that mean a longer life and lower upkeep. So...
I kind of get the idea. When you found out about Plymouth's 200,000-mile life expectancy, you bought one and planned a lot of trips not to take, huh?
That's the idea, Mr. Allen. Oops. Yeah, I gotta run.
Oh.
I'm not leaving for Tacoma, Washington in an hour.
Yeah, well, if you can't wait a minute, I won't go with you. Boy. Well, folks, if you're interested in honest, long-lasting quality, obviously the thing to do is try what we believe to be the best-performing car in the low-price class. That's Plymouth, Charlie. It sure is solid for 60.
The morning, baby, when I arise, well, yes, it's early in the morning when I arise, well, it's early in the morning, baby, when I arise, well, I got the aches and the pains, Lordy, baby, makes a man wanna die, well, well, it's a hard, Lordy, rolling. Well, it's a hard, Lordy, rolling. Well, it's a hard, Lordy, rolling. Come on, boys, well, takes the rocks and the gravel to make a solid road, well, takes the rocks and the gravel to make a solid road, well, takes rocks and the gravel to make a solid road, well, but it never gets done, Lordy, baby, unless the captains get a gone, well, well, it's a hard, Lordy, rolling, well, it's a hard, Lordy, rolling, well, it's a hard, Lordy, rolling. Come on, boys, well, whosoever mama told it, he told he told a dirty lie. Well, well, whosoever told it, he told he told a dirty lie. Well, well, whosoever told it, he told he told a dirty lie. Lordy, mama, he said he heard that my woman done leave me. Well, oh, well, oh, well, well, I ain't been to Georgie, Georgie, but I've been told, oh, well, yes, I ain't been to Georgie, Georgie, but I've been told, oh, well, well, I ain't been to Georgie, Georgie, but I've been told, Lordy, mama, sweet Georgie, girl, Lordy, baby, I got the sweetest love around, oh, well. It's a hard Lordy rollin'. Well, it's a hard Lordy rollin'. Well, it's a hard Lordy rollin'. Come on, boys, well. Come on, boys, well. Come on, boys, well.
Frankie Lane here, and William Bendix.
There he is.
And Jack Kerouac.
Come on, Jack.
Here he comes, down the road. And Pam Garner. And lady sang up a storm. And our regular gang, Louie Nye.
Hey, Louie.
John Knotts, Pat Erickson Jr., Kate and Allen, Gabriel Bell. Les Brown and his band of renown. Burn back.
Hold on. We'll be back. On the Kurdistan. So long.
The Steve Allen Plymouth Show has been brought to you by Plymouth. Plymouth, solid 460. At your Plymouth dealers now. Plymouth, a product of Chrysler Corporation.